So my name's Chris and I'm with DMM, based in North Wales in the UK. We're going to try and run through how we make the carabiners, and we'll use the Phantom carabiner as an example, although most of the processes that we discuss are going to be common to all carabiners. To get to there, there's quite a few processes, and before any of those processes take place, we would have to go through the prototyping process. So although this isn't the Phantom, this is basically how we would make the very first carabiners to the specifications that our design team and our product development team have laid out. So this was actually machined out of this solid block, which would probably take about 8 hours of machining. Reasonably quick, but quite expensive. We can then cut it out of this billet. We can do a lot of the processes to make it safe, and then we can go away and test it. And we're lucky that we've got cliffs and crags within 5 minutes drive of the workshop. So we'll go through as many iterations of this as we need to get to the right end product. And then when we're happy that everything is right, we'll start to make the tooling, and then we can go through the whole process to make this little fella. We hot forge all our snap gate carabiners and all our locking carabiners. And we've got a long heritage of hot forging. For different carabiners, we would use different carabiner bar of different diameters, generally between 9mm and 14mm. And this we would buy within the European Union. And this is all 7075 aluminium alloy. So it's made up of lots of different elements. But with this particular alloy, zinc is the most important part. 7075 is used in the aerospace industry. It's used in top quality mountain bikes, and it has great toughness and very good ductility, which would actually ultimately give the carabiners their strength. So we'll buy this in minimum drops of 500 kilos. So that's a large number of bars, and they're all 3 meters in length. Our quality system will kick in right from the start. We will have certain tests and inspection details that we have to carry out before we even accept that aluminium alloy into the warehouse. The first process will be to cut it to exactly the right length. For each carabiner, there's a cut length. We produce as a batch, so there will be between 600 and maybe 900 carabiners in a batch that will go through every process altogether. And this will help us with our traceability, so we can trace the product back to the batch of raw material that we used. There will be some bar ends. These are all collected, all sorted into different alloys. And then we have a contract with a local recycling company where we send all the alloy or the steel or the stainless, and that will go back and get reused. This product, probably things like Coke cans or window frames or other things, but not back into products that are PPE. Second thing is we'll bend that bar to the basic shape of the carabiner. So this is the basic shape of our Phantom carabiner. This process is done cold, there's no heat involved, and the bar stock is sufficiently soft to avoid any issues like marks or, in extreme cases, cracking. So we'll bend it to the basic shape, and then the fun bit starts. We've made our tooling, so we've made our hot forging dies. The hot forging dies are like molds, and they mirror the shape of the carabiner or the other product that we're making. And we make all the tooling in-house as well. So that's a slightly separate story as to how you go about it. But if you can imagine a steel block made out of very special tool steel, about that wide by that dimension and so high, two versions, one with the top half and one with the bottom half of the carabiner indented into it. We'll lay the round bar version onto it and then basically hit it with several hundred tons. The round bar is heated up before that happens. The die block itself is kept warm, and this is so that when you hit it, you spread the aluminium evenly and correctly in the die set. So in one hit, in one blow, we turn this into that. So it sounds a little bit, time consuming when you think you're doing one at a time, but when you look at this particular product, in one hit we forged in the nose detail, the hinge detail. We've moved a lot of metal about, and you were asking about hot forging, and this is it in action. We've removed, as you can see, because this is the flash which we'll get rid of later, we've removed a lot of metal, which means that this product is going to be really light. But we've also moved metal to where we want it to be, and we want it on rope radiuses so it's kinder to the rope. We want it on stress points so we can get the right strength. But in the middle here, that wall thickness is pretty thin because that's all we need. So ultimately, we're making something that's really strong and really light. But above all, it needs to be functional. And the next process is to remove that excess, as I said, which is done on a clipping press. So the product is placed on this tool and the actual carabiner gets punched through and the flash is then blown away and we're left with the outside or the profile of the carabiner as we want it. What happens here though is that you end up with a flash mark and that needs to get smoothed over because you don't want any sharp edges near ropes obviously or fingers or whatever. So this will then go into a large tumbler or tub basically full of ceramic chips in something like probably 15 to 20 hours of shaking about in that tumbler, we will smooth over all the sharp edges. We've removed the clip line, all that flash is removed, all the inside radiuses are really, really smooth, and that's then ready for the next process, which would be in this case drilling. And this is a wire gate, so we have two holes to drill. In a standard straight gate or bent gate, there would just be one hole, which accommodates the rivet, which is the hinge for the carabiner. So once we've done that, it's then sent away for anodizing. So the anodizing is a way of protecting the aluminium from corrosion. It's the biggest benefit of anodizing the product. We don't do that in-house, but we have had a very long-standing relationship with a very good anodizers that is close by. So it's a quick turnaround, and the product then comes back to us anodized. We're then going to have to assemble the gate to the carabiner, and then it will go through the final inspection processes where 100% every single carabiner is inspected. In fact, it's inspected when it comes back from anodizing because it's much easier to inspect an anodized product than a non-anodized product, should there be any flaws or marks in the forging. So it actually gets two full 100% inspections, as well as at each stage there are inspection details for the operator to carry out themselves as well. This carabiner will do 9 kilonewtons with the gate open when it's fully heat treated. If we didn't heat treat it, you would probably achieve between 3 and 4 kilonewtons. So a bit of a sobering thought. So the heat treatment sounds quite complicated and it is very, very specific, but it's like cooking. So we cook the aluminium to a very, very precise temperature. A lot of people would have heard of hardening and tempering of steel. It's a very similar process with aluminium. So we'll actually heat treat every single bit of aluminium, not just the carabiner back, but if you're looking at a locking carabiner, the thimble, the gate, an ice axe handle, a walnut number 0 or walnut number 10, every single bit of aluminium that we use, we heat treat. And we've got our cookbook. So we have got the DMM cookbook, which is very secret stuff. And we know exactly the time and temperature we need to cook the product at to achieve the hardness. And it's a two process thing. First of all, you'll heat the product up to pretty close to its melting point. So a carabiner is getting up into the 470 degrees Celsius. What that does is put all the molecular structure into nice straight lines and make it much stronger. You have to hold it at that temperature for a specific time. And then once we're happy we've done that and that every carabiner in that batch has received the same amount of soap, it then gets quenched in water. The time taken from opening the furnace to the actual quench tank is also critical. If you took too long, it would have run away in all sorts of different directions and would not then achieve the strengths you want. The temperature of the water is critical. And once we've done that, it sort of keeps the structure in that alignment. So once it's quenched, if we left it at ambient temperature, the aluminium would, what we call, naturally age. However, that would happen over months and years. So to speed that up, you artificially age it, and this would be at sort of mid 100 degrees Celsius, but for a longer period of time, 10 to 12 hours. And when that's finished, you open the furnace and you let the product cool naturally. There's no quenching involved at this point. Once it's cool, we can then do a hardness test, which is quite simply pressing a ball bearing into the surface and getting a readout on a very specialist machine that is calibrated very, very carefully. and we know what hardness we're looking for to achieve the strength. Sounds very complicated, but it's not. We know if we make it too hard, it'll be brittle. If we make it too soft, it'll be bendy and useless. So there's an optimum hardness that we wish to achieve with this product to get the strength, just as there is an optimum hardness for a walnut and a manure, or an ice axe handle, or a belay device. And it's our very special cookbook that will allow us to get there. Well, did you get my Squamish hand jam hand in?
The Yogi? Get his Yogi. The one hand jam he did in Squamish?
You weren't there.
I wasn't there.
You weren't there?
You're right. My aunt died and I had to be in
Australia. Oh, I'm sorry.
Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Chris. Did you get that on video? Did you get that?